Hey, Nita.
Good. How you doing? He's better. Doing better.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Service and let them work on it this evening, so there won't be a service this evening. So hopefully they'll have everything. Randy's got an idea he's going to try on it, so we're looking forward to that, but we'll be back Wednesday night. But we're glad you're here this morning. Let's all stand together and we'll sing a couple of songs. Ronnie's going to lead us today.
Okay, first song, Majesty. It's on page 215.
Page 189. glory, I'll see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 2,000 to my soul.
Take a couple of prayer requests at this time. If anybody has one you'd like to mention, please feel free to do so. Any prayer requests? Share.
I just appreciate y'all's prayers that Jim surgery went well.
Good.
But there's a place that's not healing too good on his foot, but he's getting there.
He's getting there slowly but sure.
Thank y'all for praying for him.
I appreciate that. Yes, Garrett.
I want to thank the church for praying for my sister. They're moving. She's doing good. They're moving her rehab next week sometime.
Right. Says
they get her blood pressure.
Okay. Yes. Well, we'll keep her in our prayers and pray the Lord continue to help her.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank the Lord for that, Gary. Yes.
I have a praise report. Virginia Dawson Booth's daughter, Joyce, who had cancer in her lungs, went through surgery really great Friday. The surgeon said that the cancer spot on the lung, once they got in there, they could barely see it. It was so small once they got in there that they took very little
from
the lung itself.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Depending on when it comes back, I guess it was whether she has to have radiation or chemo.
Yeah.
But as of right now, he said he kind of doubted that because it was such a small spot once they got in there. So we all know who took care of that.
Yeah. Amen.
Virginia's praising God, and so is Joyce for that outcome.
Well, that's wonderful. That is wonderful. Yes.
Continue praying, if y'all will, for Stephanie Stillman. She's still in the hospital.
All right.
And also my cousin, Patricia Gale. She's in rehab for at least 20-some days, I think. I don't know how much longer beyond that, but keep her in prayer. And also, I have some unspoken prayer requests.
Okay. And the Lord knows all of them, too.
Yes.
Richard?
Please pray for Leslie Fenton. He's facing several challenges all at the same time, and God knows the need there.
Leslie Fenton. Yes, sir. All right. We'll keep Leslie in our prayers here during this time of trial. Okay, anybody up? Jerry?
Just keep me and Shirley and our family in prayers.
Okay.
And I'd ask if you would pray for my sister Sheila, the one who used to come to church here. She had a melanoma cut off of her face this past week, cancer.
Yeah.
And she told me that the doctor said he got all of it and everything that they're supposed to do. The plastic surgeon is going to do something in there this coming week.
Okay.
Just keep her in the prayer.
Okay. Sheila.
Yes, sir.
Remember Sheila. She's fine.
Funny.
Funny.
Well, what's funny is that they didn't put her to sleep, just give her a local to do that cutting and everything.
Right.
But now they're going to do the plastic surgery, they got to put her to sleep.
Well, that doesn't make it look like they can put her to sleep for all of it, did it?
Bingo.
I'd hate to be awake when they cut on you.
Yes, sir.
That's for sure. David, we're glad you're feeling better back at church. We've been praying for you. Who else has one out here? Yes, Gloria.
I want to thank everybody for the cards and prayers. I really appreciate it when my sister passed away. Thank you so much.
Oh, yes. Thank the Lord that we know where she's at. Amen. James, glad you came through your surgery.
I am too, and I thank everyone for the prayers. I thank the Lord now for his healing power. I felt no pain. I had no pain.
Praise the Lord.
Medicine has never been open. So, I mean, he's been there.
That's awesome. Great.
I've had good doctors and nurses and everything. So everything was great.
Amen. Well, that's wonderful, James. We're glad to hear that. And boy, you're getting around real good. We're just glad you came through like flying colors.
Amen.
All right. Anybody else have one here you'd like to mention? Charles, you got anything you want to mention?
Yeah, I got several on the heart. It seems like the funeral homes up in our hometown's full.
Yeah.
sure it's that way everywhere, but starting where I get to know everybody that's at the funeral home. I guess I've got that page. So remember those families. We did get an appointment for Linda's biopsy. That's the 31st. I appreciate y'all praying on that.
Amen.
And maybe we'll get to know a little something there.
Yes.
And then I had another one on my heart. Lord knows all about it.
Yes. How's your mother doing, Matthew?
Mom's got a lot of nerve pain. The wound seems to be healing, but her leg looks like raw meat right now.
Bless her heart.
But she's probably tuned in. They're all snowed in at home today. Nobody can get out and go over. So
she's probably watching.
Yep.
All right. We're way better there. Dad's doing a little bit better. He's getting his memory back, slowly but surely. He knows what a fish sandwich is from McDonald's. And that's his favorite food. He switched from Wendy's to McDonald's. And he likes the fish. So anyway, he's doing a whole lot better. Keep him in your prayers as you pray. And we're all doing better as a family. Thank you for all your prayers. What a mate.
Yesterday.
Yeah.
And he's on oxygen himself. And I need prayer.
Bless his heart. Yeah.
We know where Linda's at.
Yeah.
But it just tore him all to pieces yesterday. And I couldn't imagine being in that man's position.
Right.
But it just really touched me and Brooklyn, the concern over him yesterday. And,
yeah.
And the grieving for his mom. And he loved his mama, and you could tell he loved his mama dearly.
Yeah.
But I think there's other things going on there. I don't know. God knows everything. I don't know nothing.
Right.
But I just, in my heart of hearts, it has bothered me since that funeral yesterday with the concerns for this man.
Okay.
And just, let's just pray for that man and his well-being, his soul, and just try to comfort him over the loss of his mother.
Okay.
It was very prayer.
Right. Bless his heart. Well, our prayers are with you. There's nobody like your mother. I know that.
Amen.
Nobody like your mother. Yes, sir.
Everybody can keep Randy in your prayers. He's finally got an appointment for his MRI.
Hey, man, that's great.
So hopefully they won't find too much damage. But.
Right. Let's pray for Randy. Everything goes well. As I check him out with this MRI, I'm glad they got the appointment made for him.
Right.
Okay. Linda, you got something you'd like to share? Okay.
Okay. We need to pray for all lost souls. Pray for the sick and shut in.
Yes.
Pray for our military, our country, our leaders, and the first responders. Thank you, Lord, that Troy's doing a little better.
Amen.
Continue praying for Rosalie Ring, her back problems, and her family, and Alden Lee.
Yes.
And thank the Lord that Boyd's better and back today.
Amen.
Joanne Whitaker still have an ear infection. I pray for the Michael Einman family. They buried him on Thursday. Lee Whitaker is having surgery on February the 2nd to work on those bulging discs that he's had since about Thanksgiving thing.
Okay.
Pray for Anita Cause's family.
Right.
Virginia Marshall has sepsis and a UTI. Lucretia Sperry is having cancer in her neck. We'll have to have treatment. Continue praying for Mike Nichols, Jean, and the family.
Amen.
Let's see, we did Gail and we did Anna. Pray for Ruth White and Mark Isley. Rhonda Pugh, is she better? Well, she's still on there. Is she doing better? All right. Dr. Pugh is the daughter. Panaka, the state of police, has COVID and upper respiratory issues. Melissa Barlow is doing better.
Great.
She does have just weak, she said, when she gets tired easier.
Right.
Pray for the Sizemore family. They have been through so much. And Catherine texted me this morning, and she's still having headaches, and so is Vince Jr.
Right.
And they're just weak. They just can't seem to get straightened out. But they miss us all, and pray for all of us. And thank the Lord for that.
Yes.
Pray for Flora Reeves. She fell again. This is Charlotte's sister. She's in the hospital. And all the others, I think, are things we've added today. But thank the Lord for this crowd that we got out in this cold weather.
Yeah, 20 degrees out there.
And Lord, we're looking for some more sun. Thank you for taking care of us and getting us through it. And thank you, Lord, for salvation. Thank you.
Praise the Lord for that. All right. How about unspokens today? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Charles, you want to lead us in prayer?
Father, as we come to you this morning, we are grateful to be in the house of God. Lord, there's so many things going on around us, and Lord, through us, and Lord, even in our hearts, that we've made it to church, Lord. And we pray that the Spirit of God would take this service over now and do with it as you see fit. Be in the pulpit, be in the pews. Lord God, walk in, touch our hearts, that we may go out differently than we came in today.
Yes.
Father, for those names that have been called out and made mention of this morning, we're praying your will be done in each of those lives. Lord, we would pray for healing. We would pray for restoration. We would pray for redemption. Lord, we pray for all those things, but we pray according to your will today.
Amen.
We pray for those that may be tuned in on the television there today, Lord, those that are snowed in or sick in and can't get out. We ask that you'd share that blessing with them at home today. Father, we pray for Israel, Lord. We pray for that little nation, Lord, as they go against the world, it seems.
Yes.
Lord, there are folks coming out of every corner to persecute your people, and we pray that you just continue to lift them up.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for our families, our children, our grandchildren, those that we love so much and so dearly.
Yes.
We pray that they'd see their need of God in these last days, Lord, and they'd see their need of coming back to church. Father, for those that find themselves outside of church today, Lord, that were once faithful, we pray that whatever is in their life that's preventing them from getting back to the house of God, we pray that you'd make that way and convict that heart, comfort them that are unable.
Yes.
Father, just touch us and go with us, and everything we do, we give you the honor and the glory for it's in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Charles, for that prayer. Okay, we've got a couple of birthdays coming up this week. There's Carol Stevens and Autumn Rain. Carol, you got one coming up here in just a day or two? All right, on the 23rd. Would you stand? Let's sing Happy Birthday, Carol. Anybody else? I don't want to miss anybody. Ronnie, you lead.
Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday to you.
Yeah, they have to have that flavor for those cakes.
Weather permitting, because
Yeah, weather permitting.
Weather permitting. But March the 9th is the, and I cannot ever pronounce this word right, Wolf House? Dinner and Theater of Imaginia. We're going to go there for the Then Sing My Soul. It's a gospel singing for Easter.
Okay.
And it's the dinner and the theater, and the prices are on the back. If you would like to sign up, and it's the noon show, the matinee.
So we'll be back in time.
We'll be back in time. Get rested up for church the next morning. We hope to be back by 6, but again, weather permitting and everything else permitting.
Right. Okay.
But the price back there does include the theater, the meal, the drinks, the desserts, the appetizers. The only thing it doesn't include is the tip, and you can leave that at your discretion on the table. But the reason why I don't have the menu posted yet is the lady told me they don't know the menu yet.
Okay.
Normally, around that time, it's the roast beef, the honey carrots, the little potatoes and stuff like that, and the blackberry cobbler. But she could not guarantee that, so I would not write it. But just as soon as I find out, I will post it.
Okay.
And the details are in the back.
Yeah, that sounds like it would be a good meal. So that one's March the 9th.
Yes, sir.
And the other one is February the 3rd. So we've got two trips coming up here in the near future. Okay, man, if y'all come to the front, we'll go ahead and receive our offering here today. All right. How many made a contact? Invited somebody to come to church with you this week? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Great. Keep up the good work. Never know when they'll come. Okay, Donald, you lead us, if you will.
Lord, thank you for this time we come together. Lord, just pray that you be with each and every one out there traveling. Lord,
amen.
All the prayer requests that you've heard and made mention. Lord, just thank you for another day, another chance to serve you. Pray that you be with this tithe, that we'd use it for the honor and glory of your name. And all that you do, we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I believe you're going to say.
I didn't know.
No, sir.
That's all right. I'm going to make sure all your ready instant in season accidents.
I didn't know. This song blesses your heart. It always blesses mine. Because each time I fail my Jesus, I just wonder if he relives Calvary.
Yes.
And he put this heart, this song in my heart. It was really last week to sing for him.
Yes.
And I pray y'all just pray for me that he'll continue always put his song in me to sing for him.
Yes.
He's blessed hearts. Go ahead, Jeff.
Every time I
Praise the Lord for his love and his mercy, his grace, his forgiveness. Amen.
Amen. All right. We're going to continue our study talking about the Lord and what he did in the Gospel of John. So if you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter number 12. And we're going to be looking today at Palm Sunday, which will be not too far away. It'll be here before you know it. But this just kind of comes along in our next portion that we've been studying through the Gospel of John. And we're going to start in verse number 9. John chapter 12, verse number 9. The trials of Jesus. He had many trials here. This is right after the healing of Lazarus. A lot of people are hearing about him. And we'll pick it up at verse number 9 and see what it says. Much people of the Jews, therefore, knew that he was there. They came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they also might see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. So let's go to the Lord in prayer right before our message today. Father, thank you for letting us come together, being here on a cold Sunday morning with so many of our brothers and sisters in Christ. It just warms our heart to be together. And I pray that you'll take the message, apply it into our hearts, that we would learn more about Jesus. We would be more like him when we leave. Father, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. I read the story of an English boy from Liverpool. One day he went down for a swim. He stripped off his clothes. Nobody was around. He ran into the water down at the beach, and it was not long before he found himself being carried out by the tide into the ocean. He struggled along. He struggled hard, but he was not able to swim against the tide. So at last he was picked up by a boat bound for Dublin. And the sailors were good to him. They gave him some clothes to wear. But that evening, there was a man also walking way down the shoreline there and found the boy's clothes lying there on the beach. Inside the lad's coat, he found the boy's name on a piece of paper. He discovered who the clothes belonged to. So the man assumed the boy must have drowned. And with a heavy heart, he went to break the news to the parents. And he said to the father, "I'm very sorry to tell you, but I have found these clothes on the shore and could not find the lad to whom they belong. I almost fear that he has been drowned." But the father couldn't speak. He was so overcome with grief. The mother was wild with sorrow. They searched long and they searched hard for the little boy, nowhere to be found. It was a sad house, as one can imagine. So they planned a memorial service. And the mother spent her time crying, and the father spent his time silently bearing his grief. Meanwhile, the boy, who was doing well, actually still alive and doing well, he was transferred to Dublin in a ship bound for Liverpool. And so he went down to Liverpool. The ship carried him there. And it was on the day of his memorial service. And as soon as the boy reached Liverpool, he headed for home. And at last, he got to the front door of the house. He knocked on the door. And when the servant at the door came, she screamed with joy. And she said, "Here's Master Tom. Here's Master Tom." And about that time, the father rushed out of the door, burst in tears, embracing his boy. And the mother was so overcome, she just fainted. And I thought about that. That's the way it was when Jesus died on that cross. For 3 days and for 3 nights, everybody thought it was over with. But it wasn't. It was just getting started. He was getting ready to rise from the dead. So we're starting a section in the Gospel of John. It includes the last week of the ministry of Christ. And he'll finish up some last minute details here. And for the record, he's going to die on the old rugged cross. He'll be buried. He'll rise again the third day. And he will ascend up to heaven on that first Easter Sunday morning. With all of this being taken care of, let's just examine closely the last couple of days of the Lord in his ministry on earth before the crucifixion.
Now, number one, you notice there's some jealousy. There's some jealousy over Lazarus and Christ. In John chapter 12, verse number 9, much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there. They came not for Jesus' sake only, but they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. These people weren't satisfied just trying to kill Jesus. They wanted to kill Lazarus too, because Lazarus was a witness to the power of Christ, and he can call the dead back to life. Amen. And this is the last week of his earthly ministry. The people are curious, and no doubt Lazarus, who had been dead for 4 days, was raised from the dead. And so the crowd wants to not only see Jesus, but they want to see Lazarus. And there's a great company of people that come around the Lord after he heals Lazarus. Now the Bible said that much people came. It may be there were several hundred. It came around because of the miracle had circulated among everyone in the area. Someone once asked William Booth, Mr. Booth, what is the secret to your joy in the Christian life? And he said, I never say no to the Lord. He said, I always say yes. Whatever you want is what I want. And the chief priests say no. The people are saying yes. They're following Jesus. Many of them are becoming converts of Jesus. But the chief priests, the religious leaders, they want to put Jesus to death and they want to put Lazarus to death. Notice verse number 10. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death. Now the focus goes from the crowd of people to the chief priest. These are the religious leaders of the Jewish world. They're consulting how they might put Lazarus and Jesus to death. And they are a threat to the religious leaders because many of the people had quit following those religious leaders and they were following Jesus. They were in the midst of the miracle worker from heaven. Verse 11, because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Isn't that great? I mean, think about these people. They were lost. They were on their way to hell. They were under the condemnation of God, under the stronghold of sin and Satan. And thank God Jesus Christ raised them from that lost condition. And now they're saved to the glory of God. And their foot is on the solid rock, and they'll stand forever and forever with Jesus Christ. Amen. Verse number 11, because by him many of these Jews went away. They believed on him. The raising of Lazarus was a great motivator and a witness for many people to stop following the scribes and the Pharisees, and they started following Jesus. Now, the second thing that we see in this passage is Palm Sunday. It says, on the next day, that all happened on Saturday. The next day would be Sunday. Palm Sunday. Much people were coming to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. Now we see Jesus travel about 5 miles from the town of Bethany to the city of Jerusalem. What is their reaction when they see Jesus Christ coming through the city of Jerusalem? It's a mixed crowd. Some of them are for him, some of them are against him. What happens here? It says in verse number 13, they took the branches from the palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. So Jesus began his last week on earth riding into Jerusalem on a donkey under a canopy of palm branches. The crowds are hailing him as the king. He announced that he was indeed the Messiah. So Jesus Christ chose the time when all Israel were to be gathered together into one place. He chose the location so that he would have huge amounts of people who would be there for Passover. They're there to see Jesus. And he chose his message and he rode into the city of Jerusalem on the donkey's little coat. And then we see here in this passage, they took palm branches down, waved them, cried out, Hosanna, blessed is the King of the nation of Israel. And this was another high point in the life of Jesus Christ. One week before his resurrection, he's being hailed as the Messiah. And I want to say today, friends, he is the Messiah. I want to say he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Amen.
I want to say today that he is the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's everything, thank God. Jesus Christ is everything that's good. It comes from him. Every good and every perfect gift comes down from heaven, from God. And we know that he's the one responsible for every good thing that we have. One week before the resurrection, they're hailing him as the Messiah. But the people were looking for a political ruler from the Roman Empire. They didn't want a spiritual deliverer from sin and hell. They wanted somebody to free them from Rome's mighty hold upon their nation. Jesus did not come to do that. He came to free us from our sin, and I thank God he did.
Amen.
Because when he freed us of our sin, the result carried over to our day 2,000 years later. Woo! Thank God we're still being washed and cleansed from our sin today.
Amen.
All he would have had to have done was to tell them that he's the political ruler and he's going to lead them against Rome, and they would have fallen right in. But he came to free us from our sin, not the Roman army. He came so that we could go to heaven and be with him and his heavenly Father forever. One minute he is a hero. One week later, he's going to be a zero. They're going to fuss at him. They're going to cry, crucify him. They're going to pluck his beard out. They're going to whip his back. They're going to put nails in his hands. They're going to put nails in his feet. Notice what it says here. Verse number 14, and Jesus, when he had found a young ass or a little donkey, he sat thereon as it is written. He sat there as it is written. And so, if you want to make a note, it's Zechariah chapter 9, verse number 9. I won't turn there, but that's where he's fulfilling this prophecy that when he comes into the city of Jerusalem, he'll be riding the colt. And so he says here in this passage, verse number 15, fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, thy king cometh, sitting on the ass's colt. In other words, fear not. What is he saying there? Don't be scared of me. I've come to free you. I've come to wash you. I've come to cleanse you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll go to the end of the world with you. Thank God when everybody else seems to forsake you, you've always got one in your corner, and that's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He loves you this morning. And he says there, fear not. What is it that you're worried about this morning that keeps you from relaxing? What is it that keeps you up at night and robs you of your joy? Jesus has given you this wonderful message. Fear not. That means we don't have to fear about anything. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And with God, nothing shall be impossible. Woo! Thank God. He is a miracle-working God. Amen.
Amen.
Now the Lord is laid on the young donkey, showing that he is coming in peace. What a great scene. This all happens on Sunday before the crucifixion. I mean, he's going through the streets of Jerusalem, which have been packed with thousands of visitors that show up for Passover. He does this to present himself to the Jewish people as their Messiah. But they're not intrigued with a spiritual deliverer. They want a political deliverer. John 1:11, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. Isn't that a sad statement? Look at verse number 16. You would think they would all flock down and worthy is the Lamb and worship him and bow before him and throw wonderful praises his way. But they didn't do that. They didn't do that. A week later, they're crucify him, kill him, get rid of him. Oh, yes. But this is a big day. Verse number 16 says there, these things understood not his disciples at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, that they should have done these things unto him. I mean, the disciples didn't know what to think of this unusual account. Here's the Lord going through the streets of Jerusalem on the back of a donkey's colt. They don't understand it yet, but one day they will. And when he is resurrected and gone back to heaven, it's going to come back to them. He said he was going to do that. The Old Testament even predicted that he was going to do that. What a wonderful scene this is, holding palm branches in the hand, putting out clothes on the road for the Lord to ride upon. Just a couple of days out, they're going to be calling not for the Messiah, but for the crucifixion. All the fickleness of the crowd. One minute you're a hero, the next minute you're a zero. Don't put your faith in the crowd. Don't put your faith in the world. Don't put your faith in whatever's in this world. Why? Because your faith needs to put in the one who never changes, Jesus Christ. Woo! He's the same yesterday and today and forever. Amen. He's always the same. If you saved you yesterday, he's there to help you today. If you got you out of a tight position yesterday, he's there to get you out of a tight position today. I've told the story many times. John R. Rice, one of the great evangelists of the Lord, he's with the Lord this morning. But he told the story how that he was preaching in a church somewhere in a revival meeting. And it was at nighttime, and he went out to his car to get in his car and leave the church after the meeting was over. And a man walked up to him and with a gun stuck it right in his belly. And he said, "I'm going to blow your brains out." And he looked at him and said, "If you find any brains down there, shoot." And he started talking to him a little bit, and he found out the man's condition and the man, why he was so upset. And he said the man, with tears in his eyes, put that gun back up and received Jesus Christ as his Savior. I want to say, if God can save a man who's getting ready to shoot the preacher, I believe God can save anybody. Amen. These things in verse number 16, understood not them at the first. But when he's glorified, then they remembered that those things were written of him and that he had done these things. The disciples didn't know what to think. It's a wonderful scene. They're holding palm branches in their hand. They're putting out clothes on the road for Jesus to ride upon. Just a couple of days out, they're going to be calling for crucifixion. But this is the time when they're waving the branches. This is a high time in his life. Verse number 17, the people therefore that was with him when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from the dead, they bear a record. Many of them were still around. On Palm Sunday, just a couple of days after he had brought Lazarus from the dead, and Jesus Christ brought him up, and they were following Jesus now. They had never seen anybody who could bring somebody back from the dead, but thank God Jesus can.
That's right.
Thank God absent from that body is to be present with the Lord Jesus Christ. Your last breath here is your first breath in paradise. Thank God you're going down the streets of gold, and you'll never be separated from the love of God again.
That's right.
And you'll see your loved ones that's gone before you. Praise God for that. And then verse 18, for this cause the people also met him, for that they had heard that he had done this miracle. And then verse number 19, the Pharisees therefore said among themselves, perceive ye how ye prevail nothing. They're saying, you don't know what you're believing. Behold, the world's gone after him. And I'm glad the world did go after him. That's a wonderful testimony. What a great testimony. The Pharisees said, the world has gone after this man called Jesus Christ. I wish that was even true today, that the whole world would turn from our sin and turn to the Savior and let him wash us and let him cleanse us and be born again into the family of God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. He can do it. Jesus is crowned the Messiah of Israel here. Yet many of them never did put their saving trust in the Lord. They bowed, but not for long. The Jewish leaders are going to stir them up 1 week later, calling out for his death. But now notice what happens as a result of this. Verse number 20. And there were certain Greeks among them that had come up to the worship at the feast. These Greeks were strictly come to see Jesus, for news has spread both far and wide of what Jesus had done with Lazarus, and they want to see this mighty man of God. How will they go about getting to Jesus? How will they recognize who he is? Well, verse 21 tells you. The same, therefore, came to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, sir, we would see Jesus. And that's a good saying to have. That'd be a good thing, a good little plate to put on a pulpit or on a Sunday school lecture. Sir, ma'am, we would see Jesus. You can't preach a better sermon than preach something on Jesus. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. He's the one who does it all. And thank God, friends, they go to the disciple that's always taking people to Jesus. Their demand was a good saying, sir, we would see him. Isn't it a blessing just to hear and understand more about Jesus Christ and what he did on this earth? Verse number 22. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew. And again, Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. Andrew's another one, always bringing somebody to Jesus. Who brought that little lad with five loaves and two fish to Jesus? It was Andrew. You go to Andrew and he's going to take you straight to Jesus. Verse number 23, and Jesus answered them, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. He recognizes the hour is getting close. The time's drawing nigh for him to leave this earth and go back to heaven. And he's getting ready, and he has been there for 2,000 years, friends, and he's getting ready to come back to this earth any day now. And when he comes back, he'll rule and reign this world for 1,000 years. And woo, thank God, we'll be with him, ruling and reigning with him 1,000 years. The hour has come. The time had come. He had been working throughout all of his ministry for this time. His death, his resurrection. This is the beginning of the climax of his ministry. Verse 24, verily, verily. Anytime you see it twice, notice he's calling and teaching. I say to you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. See, the corn has to die before it can reproduce and bear a new ear of corn. One little grain of corn has the possibility of hundreds of kernels of grain. And Jesus died for mankind, and millions have received him and become true followers of Christ. Why? Because this one man died for our sins. Amen. Verse number 25, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. When you really love your life, you'll yield it to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And then he says in verse 26, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there also you may be my servant. And if any man serve me, him will my Father honor. We only have one life to give, and only what's done for Jesus Christ is going to last. Whatever you do for him, it'll last for all eternity. To serve the Lord with your whole heart means that you love him and that you're doing what he's called you to do. I heard the story. It was Easter Sunday morning, 1932. The Reverend Alfred Ackley was getting ready for the service at his church. He was going to go preach. And he turned the radio on to hear an announcer say that we have come, NBC and ABC, to have a special program originating from New York City. The speaker introduced, he was a well-known speaker back in 1932, but there was one problem with him. He was a liberal. He didn't believe in the miracles. He didn't believe in many things about Jesus. So he greeted his audience on that radio that morning. He said, good morning. It's Easter. And you know, folks, it really doesn't matter, the preacher said, whether Jesus rose or not. As far as I'm concerned, he could be dust in a Palestinian tomb. And the main thing is, his truth goes marching on. Oh, friends, when he said that, Reverend Alfred Ackley got mad and screamed out. He said, it's a lie. It's a lie. He's telling a lie on the radio. His wife said, why are you shouting so early in the morning? He said, didn't you hear what that good-for-nothing preacher said? He said, it didn't matter whether Christ was risen or not. I'm glad I serve a risen Savior. Amen. That Sunday morning, he went and preached like he'd never preached before. They didn't stir his dandruff. And that Sunday night, he went and gave them a second barrel full. And when the service was over, he got home and he said, honey, I'm still not satisfied. I can't believe the preacher would say it doesn't matter if he's dead or not. And she said, well, why don't you write a song about it? And if you write a song about it, it'll outlast you and people will know he lives. And you know what he did? He sat down at his desk. He took him a pen, a piece of paper, and he started writing out a song. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. Woo! Thank God Jesus lives. He lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen.
I just want to say, when you come to the Lord, you know He lives in your heart as well. And if you never come to Him, come to the living Lord today. He came down just for you. And so we see here a wonderful portrayal of a Savior called Jesus. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Charles can come and play softly. While he comes, maybe you'll just say, "Preacher, pray for me. I've never been saved. I'd like to be a Christian. I'd be glad to pray for you." Anyone like that, you slip a hand up. Say, "Preacher, just pray for me. I'm not a Christian, but I want to be." All right. Maybe today you'd say, "I know the Lord, and I'm so glad I'm saved. And He's been so good to me. Pray for me that I'll even draw closer to Him." I'll be glad to pray for you. Anyone like that, you'd slip a hand up. All around the room, hands are lifted everywhere. Father, you've seen our hands. You know our hearts. We need your touch. We need your help. We need your strength. Thank you, Lord, that you are alive today. Even though some liberal preacher somewhere might say that you're not, we know in our heart that He is alive and doing well. And everything's all right in our Father's house. Thank God He's coming back one day, and He may come today. Lord, help us to be ready. Bless everyone that had a hand lifted for whatever reason. We'll give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand at our feet while heads are bowed and eyes are closed. No one looking around. Maybe you'd like to just come down around the altar. As Charles plays softly, just say, "Lord, I need your touch. I need your help. Lord, I thank you that you are risen Savior and that you've saved my soul. God, you've been good to me, and I've got some burdens. I need to share them with you, Lord." Whatever that need might be, several making their way down to the altar. Anybody else like to come down? Oh, He loves you. He died all the way at that cross just for you. He arose victorious over death, hell, and the grave just for you. And I'm glad to announce that when you open the door of your heart, He knocks. And when He knocks on your heart, you open the door. He'll come in. Amen. Anybody else? Just the time we need Him, He's always near. Why? He lives. He lives. Oh, Christ Jesus lives today. He'll walk with you. He'll talk with you. Long life. He lives. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Thank God I know He lives in your heart if you come to Christ as your Savior. If you're glad about that today and you're glad you got a wonderful living Savior you can look to for help, irregardless of what time of the day it is, you know that He's doing well and He's listening for your call. Let's give Him a big amen together. Ready?
Amen.
Praise God for that.
Can we just sing that song?
Yes, we just did.
Can we just sing it?
Yeah, let's just sing it all together. Let's see if Joe can put it up for us. And Ronnie, won't you come and lead us? I don't want to scare anybody off. All right, Joe, find it there. He lives. He lives.
Y'all just
played
it off
the
mirror, or
he
know what page
it's
on?
Oh, it's on page
533.
There we go.
Okay.
533.
dismiss, Rodney, if you would, you dismiss us in prayer. After it does, tell somebody you love them, shake five hands. Again, no service tonight, but we'll be back Wednesday night, hopefully with some water.
Okay.
Brother Rodney.
Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your message today. Thank you for all the people come out in this cold weather.
Yes.
Thank you for your message. Hear all the different music, sing, and all that. Just lift up all the prayers that went up today. You know what to do with all of them. We ask all this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, we'll see y'all later.
You need to go over there.